Tighten up.
Yep.
I'm Dave Palumbo, founder of Species Nutrition. From my earliest bodybuilding days, I believed in only putting the best in my body. And that lives on in the Species Nutrition line of products. I put my name and reputation on every bottle of Species Nutrition products. If you want to be your absolute best, join the evolution.
Hey guys, we're super excited to be here at the LA Fit Expo. It's our third year in a row. And what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be launching a tasty pastry. It's a low-carb Pop-Tart. It's got 3 to 4 grams of net carbs. And we love this show. This is our best place to be in LA.
Television on rxmuscle.com. This is Ask Dave. I wanted to make sure that I wasn't on mute because I've made that mistake many, many times. This is your 30-minute question and answer show with Dave Palumbo. Whatever's on your mind, bodybuilding, non-bodybuilding, it is all on the tables. We now bring in Dave Palumbo. Dave, obviously, a lot going on right now, and we encapsulated most of it in yesterday's episode of After Hours.
Yeah.
And I did want you to address something because this is something that, you know, with everything that's going on with Guru Amin Alai, this is someone that you've known, that many of us in the industry have known for quite some time. So there are those that are, you know, questioning you as far as, you know, why are you reporting this? Or why are you, basically almost as if you're turning your back on Guru Amin in light of everything that has happened. If you want to address that.
You know, it's a tough situation to be in when you have a media site and you report the news, because not only am I friends with Amin, I'm also was very, very close friends with Andy Hammond, you know. So I wasn't there. I don't know what happened. I, you know, can only speculate, obviously. The feds wanted to pick up a case against Amin. You know, I will support him until proven guilty, and, you know, and I'll still support him because I'm his friend, you know. But I have to report the news. You know, it's that's the right thing to do. I hope that we did it in a tasteful way, and we did it in a way that gave whatever facts were out there, and we didn't make any, you know, deductions. I hope Amin gets off. I hope he's, you know, goes free. He's got a child, you know, that he needs to take care of and raise. So I don't want to see anything bad happen, but at the same time, we have to explore and look into what happened and what went on, because our audience, you know, demands that of us. That's what our job is. You know, that's what my job is. And that's what this whole channel's job is. So we went through what happened. We, you know, put our minds together and try to figure out where it's going to go. And obviously once more information is released, because there's really not a lot that was released aside from the fact that we were able to deduce that it was Andy Hammond. We don't really know what went on. You know, the autopsy report did say, you know, ibogaine overdose. And I don't know if, you know, I'd like to see the, you know, the actual results and see, you know, what the toxicology of it was. But, you know, to go any further, that is speculation. So I, you know, I've always been a supporter of Amin, even when people were trying to crucify him on YouTube for quite some time, as you know, we don't have to go into that whole thing. I always stood by his side and defended him. Matter of fact, I defended him, which caused the whole problem, because I felt that he was being unjustly crucified, especially after losing a child, you know, to cancer. And so I'll always be there for him as in any capacity that I can. And that's just what friends do. But at the same time, it's my duty as a media site to report it. Otherwise, if I didn't, it would be like, you know, taking sides. I'm not taking anyone's side. Matter of fact, I am friends, like I said, with both sides of this coin here. And which makes it very difficult. And I've known Andy Hammond, I can't tell you how many years. I did this. I was the first guy to ever coach him. And I coached him to his pro card. And I've interviewed him probably hundreds of times, including his children at all different types of events. So believe me, this whole situation makes me very sad to have to even report it. But it is what it is. Same thing with Phil Baroni. I feel bad for Phil. I feel bad, really bad for the girl who died, obviously. And I, you know, and if he did kill her, and he gets convicted, he deserves his punishment, you know, no matter what my relationship with him is. And I have to report what's going on. And that's just the way it works. And, you know, it's the same thing with bodybuilding. When I critique athletes at the Olympia or the Arnold or whatever show they're doing, it's not a personal, like, if I say someone didn't look good, the person shouldn't take it personally. I mean, it has nothing to do with how I feel about them, their relationship, what they think. I think of them as a person. It's my job to critique them. And so a lot of these, you know, media sites out there, you know, who pretend to be friends with everyone are afraid to say anything bad about anyone. And I understand why, because people get insulted. And that's just the nature of the beast. You know, I decided to go into broadcasting. You know, we decided to have a media website where we talk about issues and we critique athletes, and not everyone's going to like it. And that's, I've grown to accept that, and I have thick skin, and thank God. And that's the way it goes, you know, and you might not agree with everything I even say on Ask Dave, and that's fine. But if, you know, if you do, and it enlightens you and it educates you, then I'm happy that I'm touching the lives of those people out there who are resonating with what I'm saying. But it is what it is. I can't justify it any other way. The only other way to justify it would be to not do what I do. And that's not happening right now. this is what I'm doing at this point in my life.
Before we go to the questions, if you haven't already done so right now at speciesnutrition.com, we are running a flash sale. It may end tonight. We may extend for another day, but as you see on the screen right there, 30% off store-wide at speciesnutrition.com. Use promo code FREE30. Spend $60 after discount, and you get a free 22-serve pumpkin spice isolize, as you see Lee Priest holding right there. It is short-dated. It expires January 31st, but again, you get it for free after $60 purchase after discount using promo code FREE30, 30% off at speciesnutrition.com. Let's go to the questions. Of course, on the show, the first two questions from the Dave Palumbo Experience app. Dave, my average heart rate for doing arms is 120 BPM over a 45 in a workout. Would that benefit the heart the same as low intensity cardio at same heart rate, length of time, same length of time? I don't have to do both, and I want to get weight priority, but also take care of my heart. So he's trying to see if he could manage to do both with weights as opposed to having to do cardio in addition to that.
You know, it's not really a heart rate thing, because I mean, theoretically, you could drink coffee. So I would actually probably be horrified by Sid's heart rate when he's on all his coffee and caffeine. It's probably very high. That's not really training your heart. You know, it's just making your heart beat faster. You know, if you work out with weights 4 or 5 days a week, which most bodybuilders, most of us who watch the show probably do, that's a pretty good workout, not just for the muscles in your body, but for your heart, because you're asking your heart to raise blood pressure, pump blood. You know, most cardio that we do as bodybuilders is really done to burn fat. Let's face it. You know, most of us are not getting on a treadmill and going high intensity because we're getting ready to run a race or you know, do a marathon or anything like that, or do a triathlon, excuse me. We're doing it because we want to drop some body fat. If you're walking on a treadmill at, you know, a very leisurely, steady state pace, you're burning fat, but you're probably not really working your heart that hard. Weight training probably trains your heart, you know, more in that sense. So if you're looking for heart health, if you're training 4 or 5 days a week and that's all you have time to do, you're fine. Assuming your body fat is not excessive. If your body fat's excessive, you're going to want to do some cardio. And in that case, just do some steady state cardio. But yeah, you don't have to do cardio or else your heart is going to be in horrendous condition and you're going to have a heart attack. That's not how it works, okay? Believe me, we all have athletic hearts if we train several days a week with weights. You have to. Otherwise, your body wouldn't be able to deliver the blood it needs to the working muscles. It's kind of when they make these recommendations to people, you should be doing 20 minutes of cardio 3 days a week for heart health. They're telling the people who don't do anything, the people who sit on the couch and who have high cholesterol and are in terrible shape, they're saying, look, if you do nothing else, try to do 20 minutes of walking or something a week to give your heart some work. If you're in the gym already, you're working that heart. You don't have to do extra. The only reason why bodybuilders do extra is to burn body fat, stored body fat. And there's a distinction there that you have to really make.
Second question again from the Dave Palumbo Experience app. I wish they had provided an example of what they meant by this. Maybe you can enlighten us, but is it a bad idea to eat a small quote junk meal per day for someone struggling with eating enough as long as the protein is high? So I guess a junky meal where the protein is high. And I guess if that's okay, if you could, what would you even consider to be like sushi maybe?
I think they mean like, should I go to McDonald's once a day? And I mean, that's what I did back in the day. I had a very fast metabolism and it was hard for me to eat enough clean food, even though I liked clean food, to gain weight. So when you eat like a McDonald's and French fries and stuff like that, probably the caloric, you know, amount of that food is probably double what you would get from a similar meal that you would eat like chicken and rice, say, or chicken, avocados and rice. You know, you're probably calorically, you're going to get more in that junk food meal because it's denser food. And I found that when I did that once a day, it helped me to gain weight because I had a lot of trouble doing it with clean food. And that's fine if you have a really fast metabolism, but if you're justifying trying to grow, okay, and you kind of have high body fat and you're doing it, it's probably not the best idea. You know, if you look at I have no plaque in my coronary arteries and my cholesterol has always been really, really low. Is that genetic or is the fact that I just burn a lot of, I have no body fat. Everything I eat gets incinerated like, you know, like a blast furnace. That's what I believe. You know, obviously I don't have a predisposition for heart disease, but you know, I don't have extra stuff there. And I think that's a problem when you have body fat already and then you start eating a lot of junk food, even if it's just once a day, it could exacerbate and make your lipid profiles, you know, a little off. So it's got to be, I can't really give a blanket statement, but if you're in the category that I was in, it probably would benefit you. Now, these questions are really good questions. They come from the Dave Palumbo Experience app, which is an app you can download from your iTunes store or your Android store. It's $29 a month. You get me basically as your personal trainer in your back pocket, in your phone. All my writings, all my videos I've ever done are in that one place, and they keep getting added as I do more and more. So you can find all that. I have workouts in there. We put up a workout every week. I also have, I answer people's questions in an open forum. So anyone can ask a question. I answer your question in the forum so everyone sees everyone's questions, everyone's answers. And then, of course, I do a video Q&A every single week based on the best questions for the app members exclusively. So it's, you get a lot for your money. And it's a constantly evolving, you know, library of my stuff. So it never stagnates. Like there's never a week that goes by that there isn't new stuff up on there. So it's a great thing to have if you can't afford coaching, or some people who are my clients, they still have that, or they coach with other people, but they use that app for knowledge purposes. It's a great little thing to have in your back pocket. I highly recommend that you check it out.
Let's go to our Instagram questions. Again, if you're not already following us on Instagram, the handle is official_RXMuscle. If you're watching us for the first time here on YouTube, we welcome you. We ask that you subscribe below, hit the notification bell. You're not going to miss any of our shows or segments or updates. Like yesterday's episode of After Hours, we are now pretty much exclusively live with that show Tuesday at approximately 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And then, of course, Sunday night with Heavy Muscle Radio, we're live with that show as well, generally at around 10 to 10:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. But then, obviously, there's this show. We have our new show with Dave Palumbo and John Romano, Rips and Rants, you know, really topical, no-nonsense talk from Dave Palumbo, John. And then, of course, you know, we'll cycle in some recurring guests as well. Muscle in the Morning, which we have Monday through Friday with our daily recaps of what's going on around the bodybuilding world and a whole lot more.
I wanted to mention one thing, you know, because I sometimes get confused on our own website, but on the YouTube, if you get it from our web, if you go into rxmuscle.com, then you're not going to miss anything. But if you go directly to the RX Muscle YouTube channel to check out the latest videos, a lot of times you have to make sure you hit there's videos and then there's live. So if we did a show live like Heavy Muscle Radio or After Hours, it might not show up in videos. You have to click the live button and then you'll see all the live stuff that we've done. And that's where the rebroadcast is. So if you can't find something, check it out. It might've been done live. You got to look in the live section.
So that's actually a new, I don't know, call it feature, but a new, thing that YouTube rolled out about a month, month and a half ago, right? So it may show up on your timeline, but again, be sure, if you want to watch a replay of a live episode, that's only going to be on the live tab on our page. But again, also tomorrow, all new episode of Iron Rage with Lee Priest. But again, you know, when news breaks or there is something very heavy, topical, you know, in the industry, you know, we have the different formats, we have the different personalities. And quite frankly, that brings different perspectives. So again, if you haven't already done so, subscribe below, hit the notification bell. And if you like what you're watching, hit the like button, comment below. And as always, we appreciate all of your support. Let's go to Brother Gibbs' Testalize related question. Does Testalize need to be, quote, cycled? Let me know what the reasoning is in whichever way you answer.
Testalize is non-hormonal, which is, I think, an important thing that people understand also, because a lot of sometimes people who are, do college sports worry about it. You're not going to test positive. There's no, even though we call it Testalize, it has no testosterone, no pro-hormones in there. What it does is it has herbal ingredients and amino acids that actually tweak our natural hormone levels, because a lot of people don't realize a lot of times we produce enough testosterone as men in our bodies. We just convert too much of it to other stuff. Estrogen and DHT, and obviously too much DHT can cause acne, hair loss, you know, all kinds of prostate enlargement, and we don't want that. And too much estrogen, we know what that does. It makes you bloated, and you know, it can shut down your sex drive a little bit, and people don't like the way that looks. So Testalize blunts the production. Doesn't eliminate it. It blunts the production of those two hormones, keeps more testosterone as testosterone, and then it also directly boosts testosterone naturally in your body. So you don't have to cycle that. There's nothing toxic in there. You, matter of fact, if it's working and your hormones are being tweaked properly, you don't want to stop it because you don't want to go back to the way you were, which is what's going to happen. So that's important to understand. For women, you know, a lot of women do produce, you know, testosterone from DHT, excuse me, from DHEA, dihydroepiandrosterone. That's their adrenal androgen. They produce a little testosterone from their ovaries too. And that testosterone in some women will convert highly to DHT, dihydrotestosterone. Now, not enough that it's going to cause too many side effects, but it could, sometimes in older women, it causes hair thinning. In young girls, it can cause acne on their face, and it's just not so hair growth. You know, sometimes little hairs, black hairs on their face. Women don't like that, okay? If you take Testalize, and I've given it to girls in their teens, it really blunts and gets rid of acne, and it really does stop hair loss. I know Chris Aceto, who's probably got the best head of hair. I don't know what he's talking about. His hair was thinning, he told me. He was losing hair. He went on it, and he won't take anything, but, you know, he loves his hair. So he used it, and his hair thickened right up, he said. So I've seen it work miracles. And it's not that it's working miracles. It's tweaking the hormones naturally occurring in our body so that they're in the right ratios to each other. And I think that's where the brilliance of the product comes in. So give it a shot if you haven't, especially now that we have the sale 30% off on speciesnutrition.com. Just put in that coupon code FREE30.
Made man, does it matter if you use different esters of test for a cycle?
You know, if I would have answered this question 15 years ago, I would say, yeah, you got to switch up the esters. I used to switch from cypionate to enanthate, propionate, which I hated, sustanon. I even used heptalate. At one point, we had some access to it. Now, what I realized was, being the dummy I was, you know, testosterone is testosterone. It doesn't matter. Suspension, whatever it is, it's some are longer acting, some shorter acting. It's just, it's the same drug. So it doesn't really matter how you provide it to your body. When I came to this conclusion, it was because propionate was hurting so much. Every time I took a shot of this, I felt like I had the flu and my arm hurt, or wherever I injected it, it killed me. So I said, you know what? What am I being a dummy for? Who cares what ester I'm taking? I need testosterone. And I found that the long-acting esters like enanthate and cypionate work better than the short ones because you didn't get crazy fluctuations in hormone and testosterone levels. You got a much more even line. I found I got less side effects, less aromatization, less breakouts in my skin because my levels were more stable. And so I always suggest that people use the long-acting esters. Some people can use propionate with no problem, but I just think it's a pain in the neck because if you get a shot, your levels can go from here to here in one day. Whereas with cypionate or enanthate, if you miss a day or two of a shot, you won't even notice the difference. It's much more forgiving.
I'm going to ask a couple of training-related questions and the second one for a specific reason. First one from 19Matt78. Is it a bad idea? And I know when you do get these type of training questions, your answer is usually just yes. Is it a bad idea to change training style, progressive overload, pump-based training? Should you just stick to one or the other?
My suggestion is find out what works best for you. Like for me, high intensity, you know, less sets, more weight, full range motion worked really well for me. So predominantly that's what I did on a regular basis. That's not to say that to shock my body every once in a while, maybe once a month, I would do a slightly higher volume workout, or I might do supersets or giant sets, Milos, just to shock my body, you know, a little bit and do something different. I might reverse the order. But on a regular basis, I did what I knew worked well for my particular physique, because it would be silly to do something that doesn't work for my physique. So my suggestion is find a style that does work for you on a regular basis, stick with that, but then throw in, mix yourself up, throw a superset in, throw a drop set in, you know, to intensify the workout, you know, have a spotter there to push you through some force reps. There's nothing wrong with changing up your style, but stick to what works well for you. If you overtrain real easily, and if you train too much, you lose muscle, then don't do that. But you can still change up the intensity of how you train in the gym. And that's what, you know, people tell me, give me a workout. So I send them a workout and they're like, oh, well, how long should I follow it for? I'm like, forever. I said, but you got to make, I'm not going to micromanage that workout. You have to, you know, make the small adjustments, you know, when you're in the gym, like change it from, you know, every couple of weeks, you know, maybe reverse the order, do a drop sets one, you know, for 2 weeks in a row, do supersets, you know, do force reps. That's why you hire a trainer in the gym to do that. So if I'm working out in the gym, whether I'm a bodybuilder or I'm a beginner, and I'm going to hire a trainer, it's because I want someone to kind of vary the stuff up maybe, and I can't do it myself because I'll just get lazy and I'll get stuck in a rut. That's what a personal trainer is for. That's really not what, you know, someone like a coach online is for. Now, I know that there were like John Meadows used to send workouts out. I'm sure he had a million templates and he would just every week send a different workout out. And that's fine. You need someone to do that. That's fine. We have that on the Dave Palumbo Experience app. We put up a workout every week. So if you want some variation, you can do that. But at the end of the day, find what works well for you and stick with it.
So the second one, and you did mention Milos, you've been very consistent about, you'll get different variations of questions regarding how many times should you train a specific body part? And you're pretty consistent about training once a week. Well, the question is from Daniel Donovan about how many times you should train a body part, a muscle, if you're training to failure. But, you know, there are just so many varying opinions. Like just, again, Milos will, you know, suggest multiple times during the course of the week. I saw Sean Clarita a couple of weeks ago talking about his chest routine, how one day he does, you know, heavy weights. Another day would be sort of like a pump day where, you know, he's using a little bit more cables. Your opinion on that, and I guess, you know, you holding steadfast on one once a week per body part, you know, holding true to that.
Yeah. You know, I go to the gym probably 4 days a week now. I find that that's fine. Sometimes I'll go 5 days, but usually 4 days is enough. And I train because I don't really do a big leg workout because I, you know, I have the foot surgery and I really can't squat. So my leg workout is pretty abbreviated at this point. So I'll do in 3 days, I can train my whole body. So I do like chest and biceps. I'll do back and triceps, and I'll do shoulders and legs together. So the fourth day I'm like, what do I do? So I'm not training super crazy heavy. I'm training, I'm doing my normal routine. I'm just not pushing my body. Because number one, I don't want my shoulder, you know, replacements to burn out, so to speak, or fail early. And secondly, there's no reason for me to get injured at this point. I don't need it. I like going through the. I love the fact that I could train at the gym and be in no pain. Okay, it's an amazing feeling knowing that for 18 years my shoulders hurt me every single day every time I train, not anymore. So I train, you know, moderate. Okay, so. The fourth day, I can actually repeat the body part that I did on Monday on Friday, which is, and not have a problem because I'm not really training that heavy. I'm not going to failure. I'm not lifting maximum weights. I'm not going crazy high intensity. I still go low volume. So, but if you're in the gym and you're putting 100% effort forward on a body part, chest, for instance, you should not want to train it again that week. Because you know what? The mental anguish of having to do that twice a week should be too much for you. And that's true if you have a lot of muscle and if you're trying to grow. especially, you know, people think, oh, I got a weak body part, I got to train it twice a week. What you wind up doing is you don't train it as hard twice a week, or you train it too hard twice a week and it doesn't recover because it's weak to begin with because it has trouble recovering. It's not a good body part for recovery purposes. Some people, some like my legs always, even though I had huge legs, they needed a week to recover. It was just, I would obliterate them, you know, during a workout. And I just knew that. So for me to train them twice a week, they would have looked worse probably. And they would have always been aching and hurting me. That's not productive. So can you train twice a week? Ronnie did it, but I think Ronnie would have been even better. Lee Haney came on my show, 8-time Mr. Olympia. And he said, you know what? I said, Lee, why were you so good for the last Olympia that you did against Dorian Yates? Was it that Dorian pushed you that hard that you trained harder? He goes, Dave, I couldn't train harder. He goes, I wasn't worried about Dorian. But what I realized the year before was I was overtraining. And I cut back how much I trained. I took an extra day off per week. Because he used to train 6 days a week, take Sunday off of church. I think he only trained 5 days a week. And I believe he was training one body part a week. Or I don't know how he was breaking it down. But that just that extra day off a week, he said he was able to come in like 10 pounds or 8 or 9 pounds heavier or something like that for the next year's Olympia because he had more recovery. And he's a genetic freak. So if Lee Haney is saying more rest is better and you recover better, because he was a believer in rest. I know he was. He even told the story that he used to nap for 20 seconds between sets. He would close his eyes and he'd sleep for 20 seconds. He'd get up and do another set. I don't know if that's true or not, but he said he did it. I believe him. So I think that, you know, pushing more than one body part a week is just too much. And if you really feel like you have to train two body parts, you know, a body part twice a week, you're probably not training it hard enough on the days that you're actually training it. That's just my belief.
I'll take a few more questions. Nico Cantemir, I knew you used to use 5-MG Ramipril when you competed. Are you still using it now?
Yes, I take 5 milligrams twice a day. I found that it works better twice a day. I take it in the morning and at night before bed. And it keeps my blood pressure good. I got to tell you, you know, sometimes, you know, it goes too low, actually. If I'm in the hospital, and unfortunately I'm in the hospital way too much with getting my surgeries, my blood pressure is always super low. And I've always said this. And it's probably because I have zero stress. You would think I have more stress going to the hospital. Oh, I'm getting surgery. For me, it's relaxing because I have no obligations to do nothing. I'm just sitting in a bed, right? I'm at their mercy at this sense. So my blood pressure is very low. Maybe when I first come in, it's a little higher. But once I'm in there, they don't even want to give me my blood pressure meds because I'm so low. But, you know, if you have a life and you have kids and a marriage and you have a business, it's stressful. Even if you don't think it's stressful, even if you like what you're doing, I'm always busy. I never stop. I don't have any time to do anything, which is good because otherwise I'll get in trouble. So for me, I think some of my blood pressure elevations is probably just due to stress that I refuse to acknowledge. So it's a nice safety net to have that blood pressure medication on board, especially because I don't want kidney issues because high blood pressure can destroy kidneys. Secondly, I have an aortic aneurysm, so I got to keep my blood pressure low. Matter of fact, they just had a cardiac CT scan of it, which I go for yearly, and it's still the same size, thank God. So, you know, these are things that you have to take into consideration, you know, and there's nothing wrong with taking it. Matter of fact, when we take steroids, right, we all take Arimidex or an aromatase inhibitor, right, because we don't want to produce too much estrogen. It's like a knee jerk. We don't even wait till the estrogen goes high. We just say, okay, we're on steroids. We got to take Arimidex, right? Well, maybe people should add an ACE inhibitor, you know, blood pressure medication control to that regimen. Okay, I'm going to go on 1,000 milligrams of testosterone and an anti-estrogen. I'm going to also have to take my blood pressure med because that's part of the regimen. Probably should be. I probably am a dummy. If I would have known that, if I knew now what I knew then, I would have taken a blood pressure med my whole entire bodybuilding life just to protect the kidneys and keep blood pressure in check. There's no negatives. There's no side effects. There's no I'm going to, you know, lose muscle or I'm not going to gain muscle because of it. You know, assuming that you don't go too low, your blood pressure, you know, in which case you probably wouldn't need it anyway. There's no negative to it. And so I recommend that everyone take it, even if you're borderline high blood pressure. There's nothing that could, it can only help. It can't hurt.
I know this may be fairly broad and I'm sure there are many, many hurdles that he's looking for, but question from Evan at Large, Biggest hurdle for a competitor, in your opinion, to turning pro? So I guess what is that fine line that they have to overcome? And if you can identify one thing, amateur going to pro, that one biggest hurdle that they have to overcome.
You're competing against the best in the world. I mean, you could be your best. You can have everyone at your gym telling you you're great, and you might be great, but there's always someone better than you somewhere. So on any given day, someone can beat you. I remember Chris telling me the story. Paul DeMeo went to the Junior Nationals back in the early 90s, and he was the prohibitive favorite. Everyone knew who he was, okay? Big legs, you know, Quadzilla, right? And he called, I think Chris was home, and he called Chris. He's like, Chris, there's a big guy, pretty good freaky guy here at the weigh-in. And Chris is like, who? No one's going to beat you. This is a walk in the park for you. You know, they were prepping for Nationals, and this was 91. And he's like, I'm telling you, this guy's he's the real deal. He looks good. And the guy was Kevin Lavroni. No one knew who he was. He had just won, like, the Maryland State. But remember, there's no social media. No one knew who this guy was. And he shows up at Junior Nationals, you know, and no one had seen him. And you know, DeMeo beat him at that show. But then Lavroni came back, whatever it was, 8 or 10 weeks later and won the Nationals and beat Paul. So you never know who's going to show up. So the biggest hurdle is your competition. I mean, so I always tell people, worry about yourself. Get yourself into the best shape. Practice your posing. Make sure you come in with a good tan and good presentation. And that's all you can do. If you're at your best, then you did your job. You never know who else is going to be there. I've done shows. Look, I came in second a couple of times, you know, some heartbreakers. Chris Cook beat me in the 2003 USA. Tony Freeman beat me at the 2002 Nationals. You know, there was, you know, I had some first place votes, you know, so that hurts, you know, and it doesn't mean that I wasn't good enough to be a pro. It just means that at that show, you know, I didn't win. And nowadays, you know, the Nationals, they give top two pro cards. So you just don't know. So the biggest hurdle is consistently coming back year after year, no matter how you do, no matter what happens, and being your best. If you can do that and you have the tools to be a pro, structure and muscle wise, you're gonna get there. Just don't quit. Okay. Some people just don't have the tools to do it, you know, and they're never gonna be a pro, but that doesn't matter. Most people are not so delusional. They know what their limitations are, and they may just want to win a regional show, or they may just want to win a master show. Everyone has their own goals. So, but to get to the amateur from the pro level, the hardest part is that you're competing against the best people. And even though you might be your best and you might look awesome, it might not be good enough. And you have to be able to be willing to accept that fact and understand that, come back to next show, come back next year, whatever it is. I've helped guys, two shows in a row, they came in second place. And then the third show they did, thank God they listened to me and did it. They got their pro card. So you just don't know.
Take a couple more questions. I'm not even going to try to pronounce the name, but question is, can steroids heal injuries like minor muscle tears? If you want to discuss the injury, the muscle healing properties of steroids, yeah. I mean, we often hear about for recovery, but in terms of healing injuries, and I guess your experience with that.
Yeah, you got to remember, anabolic steroids affect muscle tissue, not tendons and connective tissue. Growth hormone will strengthen tendons and connective tissue. So if you tear a muscle, like let's say you're in the gym and you're benching and you feel like a separation in the middle of your pec muscle, that's muscle pulling apart. And it happens a lot of times. It feels like you can actually feel like them separating. And luckily, hopefully you stop the movement before they tear completely. And then that'll kind of knit itself back and it'll scar over. And, you know, that injury will respond very well to steroids because steroids affect muscle tissue. If you, however, tear a tendon off the attachment or even just damage a tendon, okay, steroids don't affect tendons and connective tissue. Matter of fact, a lot of the dogma out there is that by taking steroids, you leave yourself vulnerable to tendon tears because the muscles get stronger, but the tendons don't. This was more prevalent back before growth hormone became. Now everyone takes GH and they take steroids. So the tendons become strong as well as the muscle. So if you tear a tendon or pull a tendon, healing of that would definitely be facilitated by growth hormone. That would definitely help IGF-1. Those hormones affect tendons, connective tissue injuries. And so that would work well. That's why if you hurt your joint, you know, GH seems to work really well for that as well. But there's a distinction. Muscle is affected by steroids. tendon connective tissue, GH. Now, GH also will heal muscle as well because it activates stem cells, which we used to call satellite cells, to produce new muscle tissue and heal that area as well. But as far as tendons, connective tissue injuries go, you got to stick with GH for that.
Last question from Christoph. Love the show. Would you be able to provide some insight on how you would deal with a breakup? Tom Platz talked about it a little bit. I'm curious your thoughts, how you mentally rose above those hardships in life. So bodybuilding and breakups.
If you break up with someone, start a contest diet, you'll forget all about them. Food becomes your best girlfriend, I'll tell you that. I know a lot of guys that they've gone through bad breakups and they start a diet just because maybe they feel like they're out of shape and they want to get in shape. And the act of dieting is enables them to kind of hyper-focus on that and not on the relationship. I went through a terrible breakup. It wasn't really terrible. I mean, the girl, I knew intuitively the girl wasn't for me, but it was like the first girl that I really liked. I was in medical school. I met her at the gym. And, you know, we broke up. She had some serious problems with her family. And it was, I don't want to go into the whole situation, but she was not a relationship material. But you know what happens. It's a rejection, you know. And so it really mentally affects you. And ironically, at the time, I was doing a rotation in psychiatry in medical school. It was my first rotation I was doing my third year. And I've told the story before. The woman who was in charge of the program, the psychiatrist, because it was like a tertiary psychiatric ward. It was a locked ward. So you had like real crazy people in there, like, you know, multi-personality disorders, you know, all kinds of cuckoos, a lot of schizophrenia and stuff like that. And so I went to this woman. She was a German woman, older German woman, like, you know, the mother that, you know, that I didn't have at the time because my mom had passed away. I said, I got to talk to you. I'm a wreck. I can't focus on anything. And seriously, it was tough, you know, and she basically, you know, she's like, was this girl right for you? I said, no. I said, she had problems. And she's like, well, so it actually was a good thing that happened. I said, yeah, well, it doesn't feel good. She's like, I know, but believe me, you'll go through breakups, a lot of breakups in your life, and that's what happened. And, you know, she gave me some tools to work through, and she's like, time heals all wounds, which I didn't want to hear at the time, but she was right. You know, over time, just, you know, it doesn't bother you, and you meet someone else. But so the point of this whole thing is that while breaking up definitely messes with your head initially, and that's normal, you cannot let it affect your bodybuilding. I'll tell you why. Because if you do, you will then resent that person even more for ruining the fact that, oh, I went 3 months and I didn't eat right. I didn't train right. I lost all this time I could have grown. Never allow anyone else, whether it be in a personal relationship, a job, or just anyone, social media people. Don't let anyone else ever detract you from your passion and what you're doing in life. That's the goal. I mean, that's the best advice I can give you, because true champions always find a way to get the job done. Dorian had multiple injuries at multiple Olympias, and he always found a way to get on stage no matter what, and he won. That's a champion. That's a champion mindset. We're not always going to be at our best. We're not always going to feel our best, but we find a way to eat the food, go to the gym, do the training. Bodybuilding is a hard sport because it's never ending. It's 365 days a year. Every other sport has seasons where you can kind of take a break and you don't have to kind of put that same intensity into it. Not bodybuilding. Bodybuilding is every single day. That's why you have to love it. Your love affair should be with bodybuilding if you want to be the best that you can be. And nothing else should detract from. That's not to say that you should neglect your family and your relationships because of it. What I'm saying is that if something goes wrong in another part of your life, you should always have bodybuilding to kind of be your best friend and bring you back. And if you use it that way, and you in your mind never allow bodybuilding to be second fiddle to anything else because you're having a hardship in another part of your life, you'll be a very successful bodybuilder, because it's the people who can get through the hard times and not lose anything that become the champions. And that's the best advice I can give to you, because I know it sounds logical. And when you're going through these breakups and when you're going through, you know, someone dying that's important to you, it feels like nothing else matters. But trust me, find a way to eat the food and go to the gym, and you will thank me later. I promise you, because you're always going to come back to bodybuilding, because that's your true love. If you're watching the show, that's your true love. And so never abandon that.
Before we go, reminder, 30% off using promo code FREE30. If you spend $60 or more after discount, you get free 22 serve pumpkin spice ice slice. So again, 30% off. We figured the sale is going to go through tonight, midnight Eastern Standard Time. We will notify if we extend it into tomorrow, but 30% off, free 30 at speciesnutrition.com, free pumpkin isolized with $60 purchase after discount. For Dave Palumbo, I'm Sadiq Farooqi. We thank you for watching. We'll see you next week.